congregation at Plans Road in Bakersfield, California. And it is my honor and my privilege to stand before you tonight. It is something that we young men don't take lightly. It's something that is an honor and a privilege and not a right, and I really appreciate the men that have gone before me tonight because they've done an excellent job. Tonight, by way of a reading, a quick reading, I invite your attention to 1 Peter, the first chapter, and we'll read two verses there, verses 3 and 4. There Peter said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." Now it's important to understand what Peter's talking about. In order to do this, we have to understand the context. In the two verses prior to this, in the first two verses of 1 Peter, we find that Peter is writing to the elect according to the foreknowledge of God. Now, notice that Peter specifically classifies a group of important people that are going to receive the great blessings mentioned in verses 3 and 4. So we ask the question tonight, who are the elect? Many religious minds today that are out in the world, they try to make this a whole lot more complicated than it really is. It is so simple, folks. Tonight, the elect of God are just obedient Christians. The elect are obedient Christians, but this title has conditions. Being the obedient Christians or the elect mentioned in the second verse, we are not promised an easy life, but rather we are promised a better life after this one. Now the phrase begotten us again is clearly defined as to produce again or to make anew. Thayer said it is a metaphor meaning to thoroughly change the mind of one so that he lives a new life, and one that is conformed to the will of God, not to the will of man. Now, being born again is a concept that Jesus introduces to us in John the 3rd chapter, where the Bible says that we are born again of water and of spirit, and that is, of course, at baptism. Now, with that being said, it is important to note that our new birth is not a birth into a world of despair. And to quote my dad, possibly the most quotable man in this room, according to my unbiased opinion, a religion that makes a man look sick simply cannot cure the world. You know, folks, it's so important that we address our attitudes tonight. It is so important that we address our attitudes in our daily life. If we walk around with a glum face looking forlorn, really not enjoying ourselves, what kind of reflection is that on our faith, our church, our families, and the Lord? I think it's important that because our attitudes are the aroma of our heart, that we need to address that. So no, our birth is not into a world of despair, but rather to or unto a living hope. In other words, when we are born again, the hope that we possess is not just a hope, but a living hope. Now that's because it pertains to something that will never die. Now remember, this promise of hope is only offered to the elect of God, which we mentioned is just simply obedient Christians. But we must not forget that this was all made possible due to the sacrifice and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now for the remainder of our time, I'd like to address our inheritance. Verse 4 of our text, Peter said, "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." This new birth brings us into a new relationship in Jesus Christ. And because of that relationship, we have the promise of a special inheritance. Paul ties together the ideas of children and heirs in Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 16 and 17, where he says, "The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and the children and heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together." Now let's notice the nature of our inheritance. Peter says our inheritance is undefiled, and according to Vine, that just means free from contamination. This is the same word that's used to describe our religion. In James 1, verse 27, the Bible says, "Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit the orphans and widows in trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world." So we find that what we do directly affects our inheritance. Our actions directly affect what our inheritance will be. Revelation 21 and 27 says, "But there shall by no means enter anything that defiles or causes an abomination or lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life." Now, those that are written in the Lamb's book of life have a special promise. They have something that's infinite. They have an inheritance that will never pass away. Peter said it is reserved in heaven for you. Now, the word reserved means to guard, to keep, or to be preserved. Now, our salvation depends directly upon our faith and obedience. Revelation 2 and verse 10 says, "Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life." So folks, in conclusion tonight, if we are willing to work fervently, if we are willing to work diligently, and if we are willing to work for the rest of our lives, our entrance into the kingdom isn't just one that is just kind of there. It is promised, and according to 2 Peter 1 and the 11th verse, it is promised in abundance. There are no class lines in heaven. There aren't any that will barely squeak by. No, we all have an abundant reward waiting for us. So if you get nothing else from me tonight, please get this. If we want to receive an undefiled inheritance, we must live